HarperCollins presents My Darling by Amanda Robson. Read by Laura Costello and Matt Addis. 1. Emma. After my last relationship, I was looking for love in all the wrong places. Until I began to use Tinder. Until I found you, Alastair, and swiped right. It's hard to find the perfect man. Men can be so controlling at times. 2. Jade. We move into our new house, Fairlawns, a large Victorian detached, near the river in Henley-on-Thames. Top-end comfort, top-end price. Arriving in our Porsche, just as the removal men are entering the house, with our walnut dining table. I look up and see a man and a woman standing at the side window of the house next door, staring down at us. The woman is seriously tarty, long blonde hair, bleached, not natural, smelling of Botox, not wearing very much clothing. Her short housecoat does not leave much to the imagination. Very much your sort of thing, Thomas. Not a woman, but a stereotype. As I watch her looking down on us, I determine you will not get away with it again. Don't even try it, I tell you with my eyes.
3. Alastair.
Spill the beans? What are they like? Save me from getting out of bed, you say.
The man is a serious looker, like Jason Donovan in his prime, with darker hair and darker eyes.
I look forward to meeting him then.
Watch it, Emma. You know I can't cope when you admire other men, I joke.
And is there a woman?
Yes. Big boned, neat featured. I pause and continue staring out of the window. 4 removal men. Furniture coming out now. Expensive furniture.
How do you know it's expensive? Can you see the price tag?
My stomach tightens because money is an issue between us. Dentists earn far more than forensic scientists, especially dentists who've inherited a lot of money. Top career, expanding your dental practice to inject Botox and facial fillers, it all adds up. Whereas I'm always struggling. A child and a difficult ex-wife to support means any unexpected extra expense is a mountain to climb.
A walnut dressing table. Brown furniture isn't as expensive as it used to be.
It's still expensive to me. I pause. Okay then, what about this? A fancy sofa, candelabra, a racing bike. I press my face against the window. A large box marked silver.
You sound as if you've got the binoculars out, you say,
slipping out of bed, pulling your silk dressing gown across your naked shoulders and coming to join me. Your cat Casper yowls from the bed. He doesn't like it when you leave him. He follows you everywhere. Sure enough, seconds later, this special animal, who looks like a cross between a baby polar bear and a tiger, stripy face and tail, fur like white candy floss, leaps off the bed to join you, rubbing his head and body against your ankles. Smiling, you lean down to stroke him. You dote on him. I know he's some unusual pedigree breed that you insist on not allowing out, but don't you think that keeping a cat inside is a little cruel, however highly strong and dependent he is? You put your hand in mine. I pull you towards me and kiss you. You taste silky, like strawberries and cream. My erection stirs and I want you again, even though I know you're too good for me. Every time I have you, I want you again.
4. Jade. I walk around our new home. Almost everything is in place after the move. I set out towards the stereotype's house, to invite her and her partner over for supper. Time to get to know her. Time to see what I'm dealing with.
5. Emma. Dinner parties have never been my thing. Trapped around a table making small talk. But my new neighbour Jade coerced me into accepting her invitation. With a nod of the head. With the solidity of her face. So, at 8 p.m. on Friday evening, I find myself standing with you, Alastair, on Jade and Thomas's doorstep, clutching a bottle of red wine and 12 yellow roses. The door opens. Jade. A big woman. Nearly 6 foot tall. Short, dark hair. The makeup is a sin type. Do come in. She beams. We step inside a hallway of mirrors and lights. I hand her the roses and wine. You shouldn't have, she says. Voice so hard, I almost guess she means it. She leaves them on a glass dresser as we follow her along the hallway, through the dining room. The table is laid for supper. Silver mats, silver goblets, heavy silver cutlery. A centerpiece of shiny black orchids. We arrive in a large sitting room containing toffee-coloured sofas draped with cowhide, which scream against the period of the house. Why did they choose a Victorian house when they own furniture like this? Jade's husband is standing by a cocktail bar built of oak with brass cupboard handles. I've only ever seen anything like this in 1970s sitcoms. What can I get you? Thomas asks. His eyes sparkle at me. We've got everything. Beer, cocktails, bubbles. Bubbles, please. And you, sir? He asks, turning to you. Beer, please, mate. Jade is standing by Thomas's side. Back straight, hands by her side. She is wearing a simple black cotton shift with a belt. Too plain, too simple. Clothing suitable for a funeral. Not much fun for a Friday night supper. Thomas fixes our drinks and we sit down, couples together on opposing sofas. You look pretty organised. How are you settling in? I ask. I can't function if things are out of place. I'm a bit OCD, aren't I, darling? Thomas stirs uneasily. Isn't everybody? No one likes their house to be a mess. Where did you move from? You ask. Hampton Hill. And what made you choose the Thames Valley? Why do you ask that? She leans forward and pushes her eyes into mine. Are we the new neighbours from hell or something? I shake my head. No, no, I just wondered whether it was a job thing. The job conversation always feels like pulling teeth. That's an apt thing to say to me because I'm a dentist, I say, trying to keep things light. She shrugs. Okay, so now, thanks to you, we do the job thing. I stiffen inside. I didn't mean to offend her. You glance across at me. He puts his beer on the table in front of him, leans back and folds his arms. It's fine with me. I'm a forensic scientist. I'm happy to tell you what I do. What's wrong with talking about work? It's good with me, too, Thomas smiles. I work in the city as a hedge fund manager. Jade gives her husband a look, to scold him for joining in. Not wanting her to get away with this. What do you do? I ask. A saccharine smile. Since you're wanting to judge people by their jobs, why don't you try to guess? Are you an estate agent? She shakes her head. Travel agent, perhaps? No. Teacher? Her head continues to shake. Frustrated by this silly game. circus acrobat, I suggest. She laughs. I sigh inside with relief. At least she has a sense of humour. No, I'm retired. But I used to be in forensics too, she replies.
What sort of forensics?
Alastair asks. An academic. Professor of forensics at the University of West London.
So why did you quit?
He pushes. She hesitates. It's difficult to feel fully involved in crime when you're based at a university, so distant from the cut and thrust of the police.
So why didn't you move to my side?
Too boring and repetitive. A slow, strangled smile. In this life, nothing is ever perfect. There's a pause. And I would like perfect.
Wouldn't we all?
Alastair replies. But I have to say, I get a lot of satisfaction from my job. Each to their own. She turns to me. Come on, Emma. Enough small talk. Come and help me with the starter. I stand up and follow her from the room, out through the dining room, across the hallway, into a smart, shiny kitchen with white cupboards and black granite top. A large arrangement of black and white orchids adorning the central station. The type of orchids that look as if they are plastic, but if you squeeze their stems, they bleed. She opens the stainless steel larder fridge, takes out four dishes of prawn cocktail, and bangs them onto a tray. It's ready. I don't need your help. I just wanted an excuse to talk to you in private. She leans towards me, across the kitchen counter. I want to warn you that my husband Thomas has a wandering eye. What do you mean? Are you trying to tell me that he's unfaithful? She sighs. He'd be upset if he knew I was talking about him behind his back. She shrugs. But yes, he has a penchant for having affairs. I stand looking into Jade's sad face, unsure of what to say. She blinks and shifts her weight from side to side. Come on, let's go back and join the men. Make yourself useful. Carry the tray. 6. Emma. What do you make of our new neighbours? I ask you later that night as we lie entwined in my king-sized bed.
Thomas seems all right, you reply. But Jade's a strange one. Disparaging about my job, unenthusiastic about her own.
You pause.
A glass half-empty type to be wary of.
I snuggle up closer. When I was on my own with her in the kitchen, she said Thomas has a penchant for having affairs.
Strange thing to tell your neighbour the first time you meet.
You kiss my neck.
I reckon she's a clusterfuck.
I giggle.
Clusterfuck, I like that. But maybe it's a bit unfair. Lots of people are glass half empty about their jobs.
You laugh.
But not many people are so disparaging about their husband to a complete stranger.
You roll away from me and slide into your sleeping position.
Living so close to her, I guess you'll soon find out what she's like.
7. Alastair. Driving home from the lab after a boring day, hanging around in scrubs for too long, waiting for some evidence that required urgent analysis to arrive. So urgent, the police hadn't found time to bag it. By the time it came, it was 5 p.m, so I stayed a few extra hours to make a start, but I'll have to finish off tomorrow. The salary I'm on is not enough to justify pushing the boat out and staying all night. Perhaps I would if they promoted me. Stuck at the lights, longing to get a beer, longing for a chat with Mother, hoping Stephen is...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.